So awesome. Whoa, hey, how's it going?
Awesome. Yeah, so just to start off, because it's the right thing to do, how many of you guys are excited for Christmas?
Yeah.
Awesome. So, my name is Clay. I'm an intern here with BuzzFeed. If I haven't met you, which I think I have, but if I haven't met you, after service, please come and introduce yourself. I'd love to get to know you and talk with you. But I get the privilege to talk about Jesus' birth and the significance of Christmas, and I'm so excited because Christmas to me is my favorite holiday ever. Like, November 1st comes around, I'm that guy that's already starting to sing Christmas songs, and like, I'll be online, and I'll be looking for like the newest decorations, the newest things on my family and friends are just like, oh man, dude, it's like Thanksgiving, come on. This is unacceptable. I'm just like, who cares, it's Christmas! Yo, we gotta be excited! You know? And so, like, who was here last week? You guys were here last week. Yeah, awesome. Buzz killed it last week on the gospel of how it was presented. If you weren't here last week, please, you guys, come to Joe, Buzz, or I, or one of the leaders here, and just soak up what was taught to us last week on how to spread the gospel and how Jesus came and died for us on that cross. Amazing stuff. But I'm going to start off with giving you guys a little statistic, because I love statistics. I'm not going to do that. So this one guy, he took the 12 days of Christmas, kind of like the game you guys just did, and he's like, man, you know, what if someone got someone as a gift each day from that song? And he's like, I wonder how much it would cost. He went out and he figured it out. This dude, oh, genius. So this guy, he's like, a partridge in a pear tree is pretty reasonable, right? We could afford that. It's like $34.99. Easy, no big deal. Alright, so then he gets apparently this is where he and I kind of lost communications because apparently it's not six turtle doves, whatever, tonight it is though. So six turtle doves, it's about $50. So I mean, getting up there, but it's still pretty reasonable, whatever. Seven geese a lane, we get to $150. So now, this is like a pop at the movie theater, you know, it's really up there. But now the price really jumps when we hit 11 pipers piping. How much do you guys think 11 pipers are better? Just throw me a span, sir. 200, 700, about $1,000 for 11 pipers pipe. 11 pipers pipe. Ooh. But the really big one, oh man, 10 lords of leaping. That is about $3,000. Oh my word. Granted, I don't know where you get these guys from or how you get them, but if you ever do, it's going to be some serious dough that you're going to hawk up. Just to let you guys know. And so he accumulated all this, and how much do you guys think all 12 days cost? Give me some answers. It's a few. 2,000, 5,000, 10,000. All right. $15,000 for all 12 days. I'm like, whoa, that's so good. Whoa, okay. That's a lot of money. And so, yeah, like Christmas can be an exciting time of year, right? I mean, it can be an exciting time because we get to go to maybe friends or families to celebrate, or the cookies, the presents, the decoration, the lights, the music, all these things are like, oh, they're great. But then there's another side of it, too. Christmas can be a time of not only celebration and joy, but a time of pain and sorrow. And you could be wondering, like, how is one of the most well-known holidays in the U.S., how can it be a time of pain and sorrow? Well, maybe some people just don't have the money to buy a present for the ones they love. Or maybe some people just don't have a place to go on Christmas, and they're isolated, they feel left out. And some of you, even here tonight, you may not even know what Christmas stands for. But it's just another day out of the year that you go and celebrate with family and friends, but it's just...
Whoa!
Okay, today's gonna be good. I know it's gonna be good. That's a sign. That's gotta be a sign. Whoa, look at that. Look at that. Holy I'm going to hit on three main points, and these three main points are pretty pretty impactful, and I'm going to talk about Joseph, the manger, and obviously the king and the star of the show, baby Jesus. So we're going to be in Matthew, and we're going to tell the story through Joseph's perspective a little bit more. His characteristics is not this. So we're going to be reading Matthew 1, 18, 20, if you guys have your Bibles, and you should, because we're in church, so you know. So it starts off, verse 18, it says, "This is how Jesus the Messiah was born." So this is amazing. So this is amazing, you guys, because it starts off like our King, our Savior, the one that gave his life, like Buzz said last week, it starts off, this is how he's born. This is how the Lamb of God, this is how he entered into this world. It later on says, his mother, Mary, was engaged to be married to Joseph. So these two were in love. These two were going to spend the rest of their lives together. It was going to be a beautiful thing. They were going to be there till the end with each other. But before the marriage took place, while Mary was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. What? That's a lot to swallow. Like, a virgin woman, a woman that's never been with a guy, that's never had sex, that's never slept around, that stayed pure in her life, is now going to give birth to a child through the Holy Spirit. And the significance of this, you guys, is it shows that Jesus not only was fully man, but he was fully God. And the reason this is because no other human could have been born and conceived through by the Holy Spirit. And if he was born through Joseph, it would have shown that he would have been born with sinfulness already. Because Joseph had sinned. And so this shows the significance that Jesus was not only fully man, he was fully God. He was the visible image of the invisible God. And so it continues on. And it says, Joseph, her fiancé, verse 19, was a good man and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. And this, you guys, this shows the characteristics of Joseph's heart. It shows his humbleness, his lovingness for Mary. In that day and age, the law was that if someone committed adultery against you, you had the right to stone them to death, to publicly humiliate them, to ruin their life forever. And it showed how much Joseph cared for Mary. This was the woman he was going to marry. This was the woman he was going to spend the rest of his life with. And then all of a sudden she's having a baby. And now he's like, you know what? I'm going to follow the law to a degree. I'm going to follow what the world says to a point, which is I'm just going to divorce her quietly. I'm just going to divorce her quietly. I don't want to ruin her life. I don't want to kill her. I love her. And then this is where it gets super interesting. In verse 20 says, as he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. The angel said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So now we know a few things about Joseph. He's frustrated. He's afraid. He's a little confused with what's going on. I can't really wrap my mind around this. That the woman I was going to marry is not pregnant. What? He was confused, but that's when God intervened. In the midst of his confusion, in the midst of his frustration, that's when God showed up. And he sent an angel, and the angel said, do not be afraid. For what is inside of her is conceived by God. For she will give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. And it shows the significance of it, because, like, in my life, I have a dream that I've had growing up, and it's a dream I wish my hope never goes away. And that is that I fly. Oh, man. I'm soaring high, whatever. And how I do this is I run, and I jump off a cliff, and I just, gone. That's it. But there's a catch to it. Like, that dream's amazing. I feel so real in it. But never have I ever once woken up from that dream and had the faith in that dream to go and run off a cliff and be like, I'm just gonna die. You see, the power and the love that God had that was so present in that dream that Joseph had, Joseph woke up and was like, oh, I got faith in that dream. I'm gonna go marry Mary. I'm gonna take her home as my wife. He had that faith. And you see, then he went and he broke all humanistic laws. He broke all worldly laws. He broke what this world wanted of him. He went against what this world had for him. He said, you know what? God's plan, his purpose, is so much better than what this world could offer. Because Joseph had a purpose that was to marry Mary. And he did that. He fulfilled his purpose before he even saw his destination. The purpose was Mary. The destination was the promise.
came how many years later? The interesting part too about it is that now in this day and age, we can be probably like 98% sure of when someone gives birth, what they're going to be. Whether boy or female, I mean, that's only 200 kids. Anyways, but some 2,000 years ago, I guess, they knew it was going to be a boy. They knew he was going to save his people. They knew he was a king. They even said she would give birth to a son. You only know Jesus. And Jesus literally means Lord that saves. And not long ago, my cousin gave birth to a little boy. His name is Teddy. The cutest little tank you'll ever see. And as I was in this hospital, and I don't know if you guys have been in the hospital lately, but I could not help but admire what this little kid was coming into this world with. I mean, I looked around and I saw lights. I saw a sink, a comfortable bed. I saw warm blankets. There's a little button if my cousin needed someone. All of a sudden, bam, a nurse was there by her aid. He had friends and family members welcoming him into this world. It was unreal. But you see, our Savior, the one that came for you and I, the Lamb of God, the great I am, didn't have any of that. You see, our King was born in this. Just a manger. Gross, dark, dirty looking thing. He wasn't born with a choir of angels singing around. He wasn't born in a great palace. He wasn't born with blankets or nurses or family and friends that by our side. He was born in this. You see, how is it fair that when you and I come into a world, we have all those things? How is it fair that the Savior of you and I had nothing? But you see, I believe that this manger, this thing, symbolizes so much more than just a manger. I mean, it was cold, it was dark, and it was dirty. It was cold to the point of bone chilling. No warmth, maybe some warmth if the animals were breathing heavy or if there were few people in there. It was dark in the sense of if the sun was shining through the cracks, or if they happened to have candles, or if the stars that were outside, there wasn't a cloud and it was beaming, maybe. And it was dirty because there were animals, there was manure, there was dirt, there was dust, there was flies. It's not something you would come and clean every day because 5 seconds later it'd be worse. You'd keep it dirty. You see, this is what our Savior was born into. And I think there's a definitive answer to this that, are you still born? So this manger, this gross, dirty, cold thing, wasn't just a manger. This was us. You see, Jesus entered into this because every time he enters into our hearts, he's entering into a cold, dark, dirty place. So now you have here, you have us. We are, our hearts are cold. Our hearts are dark. Our hearts are dirty. See, this is what defined us. This is what we represented. Before Jesus entered our lives, this is it. You see, we were cold because we didn't know God's love. We were dark because God wasn't in us, illuminating out of us. And we were dirty because we were sin. We had stain on our hearts. But just like how God intervened in Joseph's dream, God intervened. He sent a baby boy. He sent Jesus. And you see, when God did that, it separates now. Now on one side you have us, and on this side you have God. God took something that's cold and he makes it warmth. God takes something that's dark and he makes light out of it. God takes something that's dirty and he makes it clean. You see,
when you allow, yes, it's so important, when you allow Jesus to enter into your lives, when you allow him to be born inside of your heart, that's this, he no longer, your heart's no longer these things. Your heart's no longer cold. It's warmth because his love and his presence is inside of you. Your heart is no longer dark. It is light because his light, his glory is illuminating out of you. And your heart's no longer dirty because he cleaned you for what he did. He came into a manger and he left on a cross. You're clean. These things define our hearts before Jesus is in us. They lead us. They guide us. So if you allow Jesus to enter into your heart, if you allow him to be born in your manger, you are not defined by these things, these cold, dark, dirty things. You're led by light and cleanliness. And it goes even so much further than that, too. As in the sense of, it's so unbelievable that our Savior, our God, the one that gave his life, not only was born in a gross, grungy, dirty-looking thing called a manger, but he left the earth, you guys. He left the earth on a gross, dark, dirty-looking, rugged cross. It's hard that our Savior came into a dark, dirty world and left on a dark, dirty cross. But he did it because he loves you. Because he cares for you. And there's so much more to this, as in, Jesus is kind of like our grandma and grandmas. You see, they never ask for anything for Christmas. And every year I call my grandma and grandpa up, and I'm like, hey, can I give you guys something for Christmas? They're like, no, we don't want, or we don't need anything. There's nothing we need, And that's a similarity that Jesus is like to our grandparents. He never asks for anything, and he doesn't need anything. But there's something he wants. There's just one little thing that Jesus wants. He wants your heart. He wants you as a present. And here's the cool and interesting part, you guys, is that you can give God his present early. You can give it to him tonight. You can give your heart to him tonight. And just like when you guys get a present you've wanted for so long, you take that present, you're like, oh, thank you, Mom and Dad. Guys, you go to your friends, look what I got. Look at this is what I wanted. This is, oh, man. Jesus is going to do the same thing with your heart. He's going to be like, Dad, Father, look at what they entrusted me with. Look at what they gave me. They gave me their heart. They gave me their love. They gave me everything they had. Look at what I can do. I can go and show this world now what I have. He's never going to return you. He's never going to break you. He's never going to put you in a closet or a touch. Just to collect dust. When you allow Jesus to enter into your life, your manger. Man, these things that the world offers, the cold, dark, and dirty, man, they're washed away. They're washed away and you become fully warmth, full of light, and totally clean. But the kicker is, it's up to you. It's up to you if you want to give him a present or not. Because in return, the present he's going to give you, it's the love that not only we give you. It's the comfort that a blanket has. And it's the light that no one can give off. So as you guys are going through this Christmas season, I mean, it's not about the toys. It's not about the presents. It's not about the decorations. I believe in my heart that the true meaning of Christmas is that Jesus came in a manger. We go through this holiday of Christmas, I ask that you take the presents, the decoration, the lights, the songs out of our focus, out of our minds. And you put it in your heart, Father. nothing to do with this world, but everything to do with you.
In your name I pray this, amen.
Tonight we're going to be doing some small group stuff. But for small group leaders, if your students have questions about tonight or about the meeting or Christmas, don't even